Hi, this is Gary Collins and he's Squire. Today we have Dr. Lauren Cordain. He created the original, the Paleo Diet. How long ago now has it been, Dr. Cordain? It's been quite a while.
Yeah, my first book came out in, what was it? That was, I think, January of 2002.
There you go. I was pretty close.
Yeah, so it's been, almost 14 or more years?
Yeah.
I revised it in 2010, and I've written a couple other books as well.
Yes, and we just want to make it clear the paleo diet, that phrase gets used interchangeably a lot, but you were the one who coined the paleo diet with your original book, far as getting it out into the mainstream and actually exposing the Paleolithic hunter-gatherer diet to the masses.
You know, I think I was, you know, right there at the ground floor on this whole idea, and I did coin the term the paleo diet with that first book, and I had one of the very first websites that was devoted to this. We started it way back in 2002. Clearly hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands of people have been involved in this idea. I certainly didn't invent it. What we did is, and what I was doing with my scientific work is, we uncovered what was pre-existing. And so this is the diet that all humans consumed when we were hunter-gatherers, like this.
And that's why we'd like to have you today on the Primal Show, is to kind of reiterate that, because I think it's been lost a little bit recently, far as the original origins, far as no one ever claims that they're the creator of the paleo diet. We don't even know who that truly is. It's obviously some culture or some group of humans or, you know, someone far long ago who created it.
Well, I think it was what was available at hand, you know. I mean, yeah. what they could be found in nature and what could be hunted, you know, and gathered. So it's pretty easy concept if you really think about it. Not what could be boiled in a pot of water, because probably they didn't have very much fire back then. Wouldn't you agree, Dr. Cordain?
Well, yeah, we were, you know, before we started taping this, we were talking about, you know, what is and what is not the paleo diet. And first off, there is no single paleo diet. Our hunter-gatherer ancestors ate wild plant and animal foods, and that varied dependent upon the season, the geography, where they lived, the available foods, and it varied over time as well. So we're talking about at least a 2.5 million year period when our genus Homo arose. And so it changed over time. But one of the things that I think is important to mention is that there's two lines in the sand that we can draw when we talk about, quote unquote, the paleo diet. And the first line in the sand is the agricultural revolution. And that began in the Middle East about 10,000 years ago. And prior to that time, all humans on the planet lived as hunter-gatherers, and so consequently they could eat only wild plant and animal foods. Once we developed agriculture and domesticated animals, cows and goats and sheep, then dairy products became available. So prior to that first line in the sand 10,000 years ago, no humans ever ate dairy products. So you're right, the concept of the paleo diet has become diluted now, and I think many people believe that dairy products can and should be part of this contemporary paleo diet. And I would disagree with that. I think that there's numerous health issues with dairy products that preclude their use on contemporary paleo diets.
Yeah, agree with you. We like to call that primal. We like to separate the two, because when you're consuming grass-fed whey, some people do okay on dairy, but strict paleo does not include dairy or legumes, so just to point it out. And I think one of the reasons it probably didn't include legumes is because they couldn't boil up water, you know? So,
Heath, you're absolutely right, and that's my second point that I draw in the sand. As this concept becomes diluted with many, many people putting their ideas into it that which aren't necessarily scientific, and so the second line that we can draw in the sand, we have to go back further still. is to roughly 75 to 100,000 years ago. We don't have a real good handle on the exact date, but it was the ability for humans to not control fire, but to actually make fire whenever and wherever they wanted to. So we had the ability to control fire. If there was a lightning strike nearby, we could gather it up and then try to keep the fire alive and going for months or weeks on end. But that really didn't work out very well, particularly in wet climates. So the big issue then is when did we first gain the ability to start fires whenever and wherever we wanted? And the best available evidence, you can go to my website, and I've written a blog on this that summarizes the most recent research. The best available evidence is probably using wood-on-wood friction, and that's known as a fire drill. So you take your hands on a cylindrical drill and go like this on another piece of wood, and you can create enough friction to make fire. But it's really an acquired skill. You or I or anybody who's never tried it almost certainly couldn't do it unless you had somebody guiding you through the whole process. So we believe, and I think the best scientific evidence suggests that was the case about 75 to 100,000 years ago. So prior to that time, all foods that have to be cooked or boiled to be consumed were inedible. Cereal grains raw, we don't do very well at all trying to digest them. The same thing is true with legumes. Most legumes we can't digest in their raw state. As a matter of fact, many of them are even toxic, and some are even lethally toxic. So, and also with many tubers, some people claim that potatoes are paleo. Paleos are tubers, and potatoes in their raw state also are toxic. So,
but even if they're cooked, you know, you're still talking about a large amount of starch and increase in blood sugar and possibly a crash afterwards. I would think that during the time period you're describing is that naturally people were eating kind of a lower carb, lower sugar diet. And that's why we see that lean kind of frame on the man and woman. They're all very lean, muscular, and I would assume it's because of their diet. And what they're consuming is a good amount of fat and then a high amount of protein with a low sugar, low starch kind of combination. And that's how they're able to look the way they looked. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I think that there are certain boundaries. And in science, we call it standard deviations. There are certain standard deviations in which that those many, many wild plant and animal foods diets fell. And one of the areas where they never fell, rarely, if ever, were refined carbohydrates, high glycemic load type diets. So that's really been a product of modern agriculture. And if you get your carbohydrates from fresh fruits and vegetables, it's difficult to get roughly, I don't know, maybe 35% of your calories, maybe a little bit more from carbohydrate. And you're absolutely right. The rest then has to come from fats and proteins. So those were the characteristics, the general characteristics, the standard deviations that we can say that all of those paleo ancestral diets fell in, was they typically had very high protein compared to modern standards. The modern diet has about 15 to 17% protein. Paleo diets, our estimates would suggest that they were anywhere from 20 to 35% of calories as protein.
Would you think that's why that we didn't see a lot of obesity back then, is because they were eating like a lower carb, lower sugar diet filled with lots of protein and healthy fats? I'm sure obesity wasn't really an issue they were dealing with.
That's right. It's obesity would have been an exception rather than the rule. And it would be very, very difficult, just like it is today. It's very difficult to become overweight or obese when you're eating steamed broccoli and broiled salmon. It just doesn't happen. So that was one of the elements. But I think even more importantly, an idea is that energy input and energy output were linked. They were tightly yoked. So if you wanted to eat, you had to expend energy. Whereas now, if we want to eat, we don't have to expend energy. We just push our cart down the supermarket and throw whatever we want in there. So really, from the time hunter-gatherers were weaned until they died, there was this intimate linkage between energy input and output. And so they didn't do exercise per se. They did activities in their daily lives to help them procure food, escape from predators, social interaction, and what have you. So I think those two things on top of diet tended to make these people very lean. And Heath, and you're absolutely right when you look at photographs of some of the last hunter-gatherers before they're westernized, and you see American Indians with their shirts off, they all have six-pack abs, and the women are all fairly lean as well. So,
But well, I think that's a big point to make, yeah. And I've always said that, you know, to be fat in nature as a hunter-gatherer means you're nothing but a slow, tasty meal for something else. You know, so, you know, you would never want to become obese because then, and you couldn't because you would, there would be this line. It would just be in the wild animal kingdom of, say, animals became obese. Say you had a herd of elk or a certain elk that got fat. Well, that's the first one that's going to get eaten by, you know, its natural predator. You know, so there wouldn't be really any room for you to get obese unless you were living in a house, going to the grocery store, getting your food, and you're insulated from all these predators that are natural to the area you're living in or the nomadic way. And I think that's a part that I think me and Heath prescribe to a lot that we think is missing out of the paleo and somewhat the primal movement is people don't understand exercise anymore. They think that if they just go and eat their paleo muffins and, you know, put, you know, honey and maple syrup and everything, that everything's okay now. And they don't understand that. I always preach that it's a balance. You know, you have to kind of mimic the entire philosophy, and that means you have to move somewhat every day, right? I mean, how often
that's
would
right.
I rather be able to sit around all day and do absolutely nothing?
You know, even though I'm known as one of the people that kind of helped to start this paleo diet concept, don't forget that our research group has also looked at the activity patterns of hunter-gatherers, and we've published at least three papers on the topic, and I've written a book with Joe Friel, who you may well know is one of the better-known Olympic triathlete coaches. So Joe and I wrote a book on it for endurance athletes. I think that, Gary, you're absolutely right, is that exercise has got to be a component of all of our lives. And as you get older, it's more difficult. I used to be a track athlete when I was in college and was a lifeguard on a beach at Lake Tahoe for 20 some odd years. So it has always been part of my life. I certainly can't do at 63 what I did even at 43, but I still make exercise part of my life. I think there's one notable exception that your listeners might be interested in. There's when Captain Cook first got to Hawaii, you know, he's the British sailor that discovered Hawaii from the European perspective. The Hawaiians discovered it thousands of years earlier. But he did notice that the kings and queens in the Hawaiian Islands were overweight and obese. And so we see that. And how that happened is that they were treated differentially. So the people that got food, the farmers and what have you, they would bring it into them and they didn't have to do anything. So that's a perfect example of a situation where activity, energy input and energy output are separated, and so they ended up becoming obese. So Gary, I think that kind of dovetails nicely with what you said. There's one other example of it in Europe dating to 15 to 40,000 years ago. There's these carved figurines called Venuses, and these carved figurines portray women that have large breasts and big heavy guts and what have you. And so the idea was is that maybe these carved figurines were kind of like the Hawaiian Islanders, that there were special people in the society that got a preferential treatment and didn't have to hunt and gather. So it goes exactly to what both of you guys are saying, is that even with paleo diets, the exercise component is crucial.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. And to prove, you've made a very good point too. And that's another of the psychological side of where I go. You're talking about people who are treated specially, and today everyone thinks they're special. And I get on that. I harp on that. You know what I mean? And it's kind of that attitude is I'm special and I don't need to follow any of the rules. I can just do whatever I want and I can go get my blue pill or my red pill and I'll figure it out and just give me my miracle cure. And I think that's where we've kind of lost our way is we don't think for ourselves anymore.
You know, you guys, I really respect what you're saying. And I think that is a larger message that we really need to deliver to the paleo community is that the further that you deviate from the basic principles, I think the more your health is going to suffer. And then there are other unscrupulous people out there that have the audacity to tell paleo people that they need to have supplements. And I'm a firm believer that the only supplements you'll ever need to take is if you don't get out in the sunshine, you better take some vitamin D. And if you don't like to eat fish, take some fish oil. But in a number of scientific papers, I've shown that you can get everything you need way beyond the DRIs, the recommended intakes, way more than you need just by eating fresh fruits, vegetables, meat, seafood, eggs, and pasture-raised poultry and whatever you can get your hands on. So I think that's a real disservice to the paleo community for people saying that you have to take this bottle of supplements, this formula of supplements, and if you don't, your health is going to suffer. That's a bunch of BS.
Yeah, and I think that's why me and Heath preach. And we've both taken supplements for quite a. As athletes, we did, and I know what works and what doesn't. And that's why I've always said, and people are pretty amazed because I do sell supplements on my website, and I call them the kind of the core supplements. They're the supplements that most people who are living the American lifestyle or eating that way are deficient in.
I would agree with you, and I think that there is room for supplements, particularly people that are eating a standard American diet or are not following paleo rigorously. So,
we never tell anyone. I never, and people are pretty amazed that I don't go out and blast my supplements everywhere. I tell them, hey, this is a tool for you. This is what I do it in my writings and in my book. I say, this is why you would be deficient in this, this, and this. And if you take them to make up for those deficiencies, that is what you do. But your choice is to make it up through food and get all of your nutrition through food. Unfortunately, today, people don't do that. And then you get into the whole agriculture side of even if you are eating a proper diet, that 30% of the nutrients in farmed foods today are deficient because of soil depletion. So there's so many avenues and so many things going on. It's hard to explain that to them in a proper way because they look at supplements as a magic pill that's going to fix all of their deficiencies. And, and talk about some of the herbal supplements. I'm sure that you've been aware of and found in your research that certain tribes, certain cultures would use herbal supplements for, say, preparing for war or battle to get them, to get their adrenaline going and to get the blood flowing and also like, for appropriation.
Yohimbine bark and, they take herbs for infertility. Like Gary and I like to preach when you're starting off, like before you begin a paleo diet, most people bodies are so in disrepair. Their hormones are so over out of whack and they're over estrogenized that there's herbs and things you can take that are natural that can bring your body into balance. And as you start following the paleo way of eating and living is that your body will naturally fall into place. But there's things in the beginning that can help your body kind of accelerate that process of balancing because people are so deficient in so many areas. And that's why we have obesity and just all people carrying so much weight in their gut. And I think that there is a place for supplements, but I definitely like to follow the herbal kind of, path.
And yeah, I'm on board with you guys. There's an entire scientific discipline called ethnobotany, and what it does is it looks at the plants and herbs and what have you that are utilized by Native people. And many of the pharmaceuticals that we've developed have been directly derived from going into these people's culture and seeing which plants they use for a variety of health issues. And it turns out that through trial and error, they actually were pretty good in terms of what they found and what they didn't. So I'm completely on board with you guys in terms of that. But one of the things that I'm not on board with is people suggesting that you can't get the vitamins and minerals that you need from foods, that you have to get them from supplements.
I totally agree with you there.
We agree. Yeah. And, yeah. You know, obviously that's the preference, is if everybody can get, you know, the vitamins and nutrition they need from their food. And in the beginning, it's oftentimes difficult because people are very lazy, and that comes from their hormones being out of whack. So we had a show a couple episodes ago where we talked about how to get your body kind of in balance and getting geared, kind of doing a cleanse, almost like a colon cleanse, before you begin a paleo diet. Because oftentimes people are so lethargic, they don't have that urge or desire to want to go out and go to the gym, start making better food choices. So we're telling them to cleanse first, then go into a paleo diet to get more energy. So
that's the toughest part, yeah. Though, right, Heath, is that we're fighting this battle of the organism is very sick and it is very unmotivated. That's the best way to put it. And how do you get that jump start to get it motivated? Because we all know, because we're in this. I mean, heck, Dr. Cordain, you've been doing this a large part of your life, that you have to get over that hump of where you don't feel so crappy to where you have the energy and will to actually do the things that we're preaching. And I think we get removed, and I'm guilty of this too, because me and you have talked about it, Dr. Cordain, about we come from athletic backgrounds, and you know, we were very competitive athletes and always considered ourselves such, but we forget that most people today have never even done an athletic event. Heck, they don't even have PE in some schools anymore. So to get these people motivated, to get them over that hump, get them into that set where they go, oh, here's the energy levels. Now I get it. It's very difficult. And I think what happens is it's the yo-yo effect that we've all seen. You know, they get on it for 2 weeks, they get on it for 30 days, they start feeling better, feel a little crappy in the beginning, feel better, and then they fall off and they go right back into it again. And it's the roller coaster of the American lifestyle right now. But long as you can, that's why we talk about cleanses. Was there anything you found in your research to where any of the indigenous people would actually do like a fasting or herbs or plants in order to detoxify throughout seasons?
Yeah, I'm not really an expert in that area. That's kind of the ethnographic literature, and you know, I've read quite a bit of it, and they certainly did. They had a lot of beliefs. You know, fasting was part of it to prepare themselves. Even going out on a hunt, they would sometimes wash themselves, you know, so that they didn't have body odor and those kind of things. So yeah, there's a lot of I think behavioral practices that go on in our ancestral people and contemporary hunter gatherers, which aren't not a whole lot of them left anymore. But I think one of the big points here is stating the obvious. And you know, it's like the king doesn't wear clothes, the little boy said. And so I think that's really what paleo is about, is simply stating the obvious. And the obvious is this: 70% of our calories in the typical U.S. diet come from four food groups: refined sugars, refined grains, refined vegetable oils, and dairy products. Now, we can call that a pizza, a donut, a cookie, a cracker, a bagel, or whatever, what have you, but it's junk food. And 70% of the calories from the time we're weaned until we die come from those four food groups. And I think to really put it in it perspective is get yourself on your kitchen table and put a pile of white sugar, put it right next to it a pile of white flour, then put a cup of vegetable oil, and then put a little bottle of milk next to it, and think that that's what I will eat. That's 70% of my calories every day, day in and day out. So to me, that is stating the obvious. And I think that once you get people off of processed foods and get them eating real foods, I think what you're talking about, the energy, and even I think the behavioral part of this is it makes them want to stay on it because they feel so crappy, as you put it, when they go back and eat those kind of foods again. And I've heard that time and again anecdotally as people say, golly, I went on paleo and I decided I'm going to go out and have a donut for breakfast with my coffee or whatever. People tell me that they feel so bad when they do it, it's like they don't want to do it again.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a, you know, self, what do you want to, cyclic. It's kind of self-serving.
Well, and that's why I talk about getting over the hump. And I always tell people, if you can just stick with me for 30 days, get on this path for 30 days, that's usually kind of the threshold for them to be able to get through the detoxification, get some of those toxic chemicals and everything that they ingest, not only from food, but all the things they put on their body too. That's a topic for a whole nother show.
It sure is.
Chemicals that we are dousing ourselves with every day. But to get them to that 30 days, I noticed that's a huge success point.
Yeah, we talked to Dr. Mark Smith last week.
Did you guys know that Mark was a graduate student of mine?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, Mark is a great guy. He's really knowledgeable.
We talked to him about transitional foods and how, you know, my focus for my business, Julian Bakery, is helping people transition from a mainstream diet into the paleo way of eating and kind of combining real food with this transitional food made from paleo ingredients that are within the guidelines of paleo to help people stay on track. Because so many people are falling off of track and because paleo can be really hard in the beginning. So my foods try to keep people on track so that they have, you know, that long lasting results. And we found, you know, obviously hundreds of thousands of people are following, you know, that kind of tempo. They need transitional foods to kind of help keep them on track.
Oh, you know, I'm so proud of both of you guys. You are such eloquent spokes people for this idea. And I know your products at Julian Bakery, Heath, are just wonderful. I support many of those products. And I do know that they help people make that transition. So, you know, when you tell somebody that you really shouldn't be eating bread or cereal grains, that's a tough transition for a lot of folks. And a lot of the foods, you know, that fast foods that people like are made with bread or corn as tortillas or as wraps or what have you. And you've done a real service to the paleo community by coming up with these products that are non-grain based, even though it's Julian's Bakery, that help people to make that transition. So I applaud both of you.
Oh, thank you. I got to see you on Dr. Oz earlier this year. That was a great show, and congratulations. That was great to get paleo out in front of the mainstream society, and you must be so proud to see paleo spread to these professional athletes now that are embracing the paleo diet and getting amazing results. Most recently, Gary told me about LeBron James using the paleo diet and doing like a low-carb, kind of low-sugar template to get incredible results, to drop weight. Can you speak a little bit about, you know, what you're seeing out there in terms of mainstream embracing the paleo diet?
You know, I don't get on the internet and look this stuff up very often, so I kind of hear it secondhand through other people that are more, you know, interested in that. And I'm totally flattered. I am absolutely flattered to hear, you know, that this has really gone mainstream and professional athletes are doing it. And, you know, I think paleo can definitely be ergogenic. And I've written about that in a book that I wrote with Joe Friel. He's an old friend from Fort Collins, and he's one of the better known U.S. Olympic triathlete coaches. And so we actually, in the intro to that book, we talked about why paleo is ergogenic, why it helps to build muscle and strength and helps athletes. So that little intro is actually on my website now as a blog. It's just, I don't know, 1,000-word intro. So people who are interested in seeing the science behind that, they certainly can.
Yeah, you get to see.
I have that book, Dr.
Well, thanks.
It's a great book. Being an athlete and training and working with athletes, I'm not too athletic anymore. I'm more of consider myself getting to be a broken down old man, but
well, you know, I am, so I'm not getting to be. I'm there.
Oh, gosh, yeah. You know, but I find it very interesting, LeBron James, because some of the heat that we've gotten recently in some of the paleo groups about that it's about feeling healthy and not being lean. And we're all, yeah, we get that. But LeBron James is a perfect example. Here's a guy who is a very, very well-conditioned athlete. He didn't do it to get ripped. He did it because he knew it was an anti-inflammatory diet, and he knew that as he aged and being a basketball player, by being lighter and putting less pressure on his joints, was going to make him a better player. But in the process, guess what he got? He got ripped and got a six-pack, but that was not his goal ever. That was not what he was going for. But the end result was a very lean guy.
You know, I can anecdotally, I can say the same thing. I've been married for 24 years. My wife, Lori, when I met her, was in her early 30s, and she was a triathlete, and she was, you know, doing the basic high-carb, low-fat type diet that everybody was doing in the 80s and 90s, thinking it was healthful. So after she met me and we got married in 1990, she went on paleo, just like what I was doing. And she noticed that she got more muscular, and her training didn't even change at all. And so I think that particularly for people in their prime, you know, and even people a little beyond their prime in their 30s and 40s and maybe even in their 50s, I think people notice that, is that it is anabolic. It you seem to develop more definition and more muscle mass with this type of a diet.
Well, and I tell people, you know, it's very simple. It's if you're doing it right, doing it correctly, and not just the diet. This is, again, a part that the paleo community right now doesn't get, because a lot of them don't come from athletic backgrounds at all, is that you have to do it all. You know, if you do the diet correctly and you're getting proper exercise and movement, you get lean.
Gary, you made a really good point that I just want to, you know, emphasize, is that paleo is an anti-inflammatory diet as it's configured. If you don't eat grains and you don't eat legumes, it tends to be anti-inflammatory. And if you include, I understand there's a famous blogger these days that now tells paleo community that legumes are okay. Legumes are pro-inflammatory in our gut, and we've known that. We have animal models of that, we have human models, and we have tissue models, and they're pro-inflammatory for a variety of reasons. So I think that's really a bad idea, whoever is now promoting legumes as being part of paleo.
Well, also this year on Dr. Oz, Chris Kresser was on Dr. Oz and saying that legumes were a part of paleo, and I think it sent such a confusing message, because obviously the Dr. Oz show goes out to millions of people, and you know, what we're here to say is that legumes are not part of the paleo diet, because the paleo diet is an anti-inflammatory diet and legumes have no part in it. And I think neither do potatoes, and potatoes are another one that are trying to be added back in currently. And it's so confusing when you see somebody go on a mainstream show like that and send that kind of message.
Well, I think, you know, part of it is you have to realize, you know, who's delivering the message and what their background is. I've been, as I mentioned, I've been a professor at a Division I research institution, publishing scientific papers on this for peer review. And so when we say something, it's backed up by the bulk, the majority of the scientific literature. And I don't know who Chris Kresser is. I've never met him.
He's an acupuncturist.
Okay, so he's an acupuncturist. Well, if he believes that Stone Age people ate legumes, maybe he ought to write a paper submitting it to a peer-review scientific journal. But once again, we talked about the lines in the sand. And the first line in the sand was the development of agriculture. Before that, you couldn't eat meat. The second line in the sand was the ability to start a fire whenever and wherever you wanted it. Legumes can't be consumed in their raw state. So that, even though 75 to 100,000 years ago sounds like a long, long time ago, on a 24-hour time clock, that represents anywhere from 24 to 36 minutes to midnight of the last hour of that 24-hour time clock. So we simply, as a species, don't do very well. And legumes are not nutrient-dense foods either. They're a you know, they're very poor source of the 13 vitamins and minerals most lacking in the typical U.S. diet. So why in the world would you want to eat those anyway, unless you have some sort of addiction to chili beans? Yeah. I just don't get it.
And the phytic acid would, that problem too is to, the phytic acid blocks what nutrients it does have, so you can't absorb some of the minerals and vitamins that are in the bean legume to begin with. And I always ask people, I go, why do you want to incorporate something that takes so much effort to eat, is nutritionally pretty poor, and doesn't have much taste, but you're fighting for it? You know why they're fighting for it? And here's my problem, and Heath has this as well, is the attitude of, I'm not going to give you what you need, I'm going to give you what you want. So instead of getting you away from the sugars and starches that you should be taking out of your diet, I'm going to reincorporate them in a sneaky way in some food that we'll call natural, but it's still high in starch, it's still low in nutrition, and it's high in inflammation. And I just don't get this whole thought process. Why would you do that?
I'm completely on board with that, and I've written an extensive blog when I found out that Chris Kresser was pushing legumes. I've written an extensive blog showing exactly that. You can go to my website, thepaleodiet.com, and read about it. It's one of the more popular blogs I've ever written. I've also got another blog on potatoes, why they're also pro-inflammatory. And then I've got a blog showing when and how fire was first controlled. And so
I've read, I think, all those together, Dr. Cordain. They're excellent, by the way.
Yeah, and one final point on the legume situation is some unknowledgeable experts, and I don't know if this is Chris Kresser or whoever's pushing this, even after they're cooked, legumes and potatoes and potatoes actually still contain what are called saponins. And saponins, like the word sounds like soap, and that's exactly what they are. And so if you put saponins on a cell membrane, whether it's the inside of your gut, your tongue, and your red blood cell, anywhere, if you put a saponin, it breaks down the membrane. And so we know from human and animal studies that saponins tend to cause a leaky gut. And that's why these things tend to be pro-inflammatory, because we have two basic types of bacteria in our gut. We have gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. And the gram-negative bacteria, outside of their cell walls, contain a compound called lipopolysaccharide, or LPS. And LPS is hugely pro-inflammatory. I don't know if you guys have gotten into that. But that's why when the gut becomes leaky, that's one of the major problems, is LPS binds specific cells in the gut called dendritic cells. And dendritic cells contain what are called toll-like receptors, toll-like receptor 4. And when LPS binds this toll-like receptor 4, it immediately upregulates or causes a synthesis of pro-inflammatory cytokines. Cytokine is a localized hormone. So this isn't just a theory. This is the best science is. And for someone to make an irresponsible statement like, let's now include legumes as part of paleo, no. What I say is we've got an 85-15 rule that I built into all of my books. And you know what? If you want to go out and have a bowl of chili once in a blue moon, do it. You know, if it's going to psychologically help you to stay on this diet longer, do it. Just don't do it on a regular basis. So
yeah, and you make an excellent point, Dr. Cordain. And that their argument now is that by boiling the beans, boiling potatoes, that you get rid of most of the phytic acid, which is true. Which is true, but not all of it. I always tell them, not all of it. And you made a good point that soap-like substance, you can see it when you boil them because it becomes foamy and it bubbles just like soap.
Exactly.
And you try and tell these people this, and they just go on Google and they shoot you 15 bazillion articles on how ancient cultures ate beans and how, you know, the phytic acid is all boiled out. And you just sit there and go, guys, we're all in this together. let's use our heads and let's do the best for the consumer and the people we're trying to teach. And if you're going to fight for a bean, don't call it paleo. Call it
exactly.
Else.
Call it the Chris Kresser bean diet.
Yeah.
Call it the Chris Kresser bean gassy diet.
There's nothing wrong with having a variation of the paleo diet and calling it a paleo template. That's fine, but keep within the guidelines of your research. You know, it's completely disrespectful when I see something like on Chris Kresser's Twitter page that says, don't follow, you know, the paleo diet. It actually says, follow your own paleo code. I think it's disrespectful to your research that you did. And we're all about, you know, that modifying the paleo diet for your own person, but it has to be within the guidelines and your research.
Yeah. First off, we shouldn't listen to any charismatic individual, and hopefully I'm not quote unquote a charismatic individual. What we need to do is we need to always let the data guide us. Okay. Yeah. So that, and you know, we simply pointed out what the data suggests. And so I'm not the only scientist that says that legumes were not part of human normal diets. My colleague Stefan Lindeberg and many others that have studied this and spent their careers doing it from an academic perspective, you know, we all kind of converge upon the same notion. So, I agree. Don't listen to me as the final expert. Let the data always speak for itself. And so if you think that legumes should be part of paleo, then you go out and research it yourself and find the information that says either one way or another. Because ultimately, in the end, we all have to make our own decisions. But I am firmly convinced that line in the sand has been drawn, and humans simply did not eat legumes until fairly recent times. So anyway, we can move on.
Well,
that's a bunch of beans.
But what this does is this dovetails in a great kind of topic that I always preach, and I always have, and I've said, don't listen to me. I always say the same thing too. Don't listen to me. I'm not an expert. I don't research this stuff every day, but I'm a very good, I came from an investigative background. I'm very good at putting together facts for myself and for others. But to think of it and go, okay, always put yourself back out in nature. And this is what I talk to my clients about. If you're ever confused, just stick yourself out in the forest, put in your mind and go, okay, what is around me? Would there be beans around me? And would I have time to, if I was out and hunter gathering in a nomadic type of lifestyle, would I have time to sit down, go find the beans, cultivate them, boil them, make them into no. I mean,
What would be around you? Protein,
yeah.
Followed by some fat, vegetables, and probably a small amount of fruit. Nuts. But if you look at that diet, it's a low sugar, low starch diet that's got high protein and a moderate amount of fat. And that's why these people look the way they did. And that's why Gary and I talk about this all the time, Dr. Cordain, that if you're looking to lose weight in a faster pace, is to modify the paleo diet to be a low carb, low sugar diet for accelerated weight loss. And it's a really simple principle, because the research you did proves the fact that these people were lean and sculpted. But if you modify it to be even lower sugar and lower carb, people can have accelerated weight loss, reach their goal quicker, and then adjust their intake of fruit and carbohydrates accordingly after you reached your goal. But what Gary and I are all about is reaching your goal quickly, and then you get to enjoy some more fruit and additional sugar, but not until the point that you reach your kind of ideal weight.
When you have to adjust your metabolism too, and that's another thing we're talking about, is you're not going to know what your carbohydrate load or anything is, how much fruit you're going to be able to get away with, until you get to that point to where your metabolism is functioning at its normal healthy rate, even though metabolism changes up, down, depending, you know.
You guys are making some really good points. And what we're finding out now with randomized controlled trials, which are the most powerful way to test any nutritional idea, is put humans on this, get a control group, and go back and forth and see if these things work one way or another. And one of the elements that's coming out of randomized controlled trials is that higher protein diets help people to lose weight. It's the best way to get weight off and keep it off. And we know now mechanistically how this works, because it changes a variety of gut hormones. One in particular is called PYY. And PYY influences the hypothalamus. And so it's released in the gut in greater concentrations with more and more protein in your diet. So, and there's other mechanisms. It's also protein is much more satiating than the other two macronutrients. So, you know, you talk about LeBron James getting ripped up. I would imagine that part of it has to do with the higher protein in his diet. Also, protein, animal protein is a rich source of branched chain amino acids, leucine, isoleucine, and valine. And we know that those three amino acids are anabolic, particularly when they're consumed in that post-exercise window that can extend out to, if you have a workout that goes an hour or 2 hours, that post-exercise window can go roughly the length of the exercise or maybe a little bit longer when the muscles are still able to suck up those branched chain amino acids and immediately turn them into muscle. Another point that Gary, you made, I want to follow up on this is you talk about being out in the forest, what can you eat? Well, hunter-gatherers just didn't go out and randomly look for food. They searched for food which with a process called optimal foraging theory. And what optimal foraging theory is, it means that you've got to go out and you've got to expend less energy than the energy you get out of the food. So it's kind of like going to the bank, you know, and withdrawing more money than you have. You absolutely have to gain more energy than the energy you expend to get it. And so in order to do that, they targeted specific foods that were more concentration sources of energy. The first foods they targeted were animal foods, because animal foods are always more energetically dense, almost always, than our plant foods. And they favored larger animals because they didn't have to expend, they could get more bang for the buck. Larger animal gives you more energy. And then if they went out and they were hunting or fishing and they didn't get a damn thing and they came back and there was a patch of broccoli or what have you over next to the camp, then they might bring that in and that would be the food that they would have if they weren't successful with animal foods. So that's kind of how the whole thing was governed. And your point was well taken, Gary, is that if they had to build a fire to process the food, then that takes more energy. And so they'd much rather not necessarily have to do that. So,
well, it's just like with any animal. You're right. We're programmed to use the least amount of energy to get the most amount of result. And that's why we also became nomadic, is because we had to follow the foods that were most energy dense, which would be herd animals, that would be herbivores, that would be following also and moving around to get to certain grasses after they had cleaned out an area. They would have to move because now they've got to go to their food source. So we follow that food source in order to go get it. And I think we've just lost complete touch.
There's a, you know, that brings up a thought that I had. There was a fascinating archaeological find just discovered in 2013 on the east side of the British Isles, right next to the ocean. And it was during a rainstorm, and there was a bunch of archaeologists that were excavating another site. And they walked down close to the ocean, and they found human footprints in that had been fossilized in the ancient shoreline there. And they were able to date them to 900,000 years ago, almost a million years ago. And you could see the toes, you could see the heel, just absolutely fascinating. Well, obviously, these are naked people. They didn't have clothing, they didn't have shoes, and they originated from Africa. So they walked out of Africa and got all the way to the UK, and they were on the shorelines. Now, the UK, even in interglacial times, was cold in the winter, cold and rainy, because of its geographic location. So what were they eating? What were they consuming? You know, they were doing optimal foraging theory. And so to be able to leave Africa, they had to have the behavioral sophistication, not just to scavenge large animals, but to get them constantly year round. Well, how did they do that? They probably did it with a sharp stick. They didn't have bows and arrows. They had no slings. So that's probably how it was done. They probably went out, and you talk about fitness. Here's, you know, maybe six guys that went out together with nothing but a sharpened stick and their brains, and they went after large, large animals. So tell me how fit you have to be to do that, is to chase down a large animal with a stick. Yeah. You have to be very, very incredibly fit.
But how would you be able to perform that type of movement and exercise by eating legumes and grasses? I mean, eventually you would nutritionally starve to death and you'd become emaciated. You would have nothing left. So you have to, it's common sense. And I think that's the problem. I think why we get along so well, Dr. Cordain, is we all think of, we're making this too complicated, guys. Just
the obesity epidemic is made way too complicated, you know. Yeah. Get processed foods, the 70% of the calories we talked about, refined grains, refined sugars, refined vegetable oils, and processed food. Get that out of there, and we wouldn't have much of an obesity epidemic.
Well, now the new thing, and me and Heath have been talking about this, is ketogenic diets have become very, very popular. And I've explained that ketogenic, because they've taken the term ketogenic and they've turned it into a high-fat diet, when the definition of ketogenic is beginning to use or utilizing ketone bodies for energy. It has nothing to do with gobbling down 70, 80% of your calories in fat. It's just being able to utilize ketone bodies as energy. That's what ketogenic means.
Yeah,
and
good point. They've
totally turned it into something else, and now it's like eat 5 sticks of butter a day with an egg or whatever, and now you're doing a ketogenic diet. And again, I think your research would prove too, and Mark brought this up, is that there's no animal that has over 50% fat on its body. So why would you ever eat a diet that is exceeding what is in nature? You know, you would never be able to consume your that many calories in just pure fat. And if you did it, it would be probably, like you said, scavenging. You maybe found a dead seal or maybe a whale washed up on the shore, and that you ate a lot of fat in the winter to kind of get by. But you wouldn't eat that type of diet long term, correct? I mean, it would be impossible.
That's right. Our research group, and Mark may have been involved in this one. He was one of my doctoral students way back when. But we actually developed the first equations that allow you to predict the number of calories from protein and fat based on an animal's body fat percentage. And these are what are called third order polynomials. And so we published that in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. And basically what it is, it's a universal tool that allows scientists for the very first time to say, okay, we've got a squirrel with 5% fat. How many, if you eat the whole squirrel, how many calories do you get from fat and how many you get from protein? So any of the interested listeners can actually see those equations. But the take home point here is precisely what Mark has said, is that when we eat wild animals, they come as a package, mainly of protein and fat. And even the very fattest of all animals aren't anywhere close to contemporary domesticated animals like a hog or a feedlot-produced cow. So our hunter-gatherer ancestors then were forced to eat a higher protein diet because they were opportunistic. They would try to eat everything they possibly could, but there actually is a physiologic protein ceiling that for most modern people is between 35 and 40% of their total calories. So if any of your listeners are interested, go out and get yourself some lean chicken breast with no skin on it and some water-packed tuna and try to eat only that food for 3 days, and you'll get very, very sick indeed, because you can't eat that much protein. As I mentioned, metabolically, what happens is there are byproducts of protein metabolism that end up being toxic to our body, and we simply can't get rid of them. So that was the real dilemma that hunter-gatherers faced, is how do you eat these wild animals? And one of the things that they did, they ate right up to their protein limits. They selectively butchered the animals, so they really liked the fatter parts of the carcass, like the marrow. So any hunter-gatherer worth anything, by the time they were 4 years old, they knew about marrow, because marrow is a good source of fat. And amazingly, it contains monounsaturated fats primarily. And to our taste buds, to human taste buds, monounsaturated fats seem to taste a little bit better to us than saturated fats. They also selectively ate the fattier organs. Now, brain actually contains technically no fat. Okay, there's fatty acids are found in as structural fats and as storage fat. And so structural fats are phospholipids, storage fats are triglycerides. The brain has virtually no triglyceride, but it has a ton of fatty acid in the phospholipid fraction. So the brain is a, you know, hunter-gatherers didn't care. It was quote-unquote a fatty food to them. But it actually isn't triglyceride, it's phospholipids. And so these are some of the subtleties. You know, when we hear, you know, acupressurists or acupuncturists trying to talk science to us, they don't even know the details. They haven't even read the journal articles, and they don't have the biochemistry background to understand what they're reading.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's what's happened too today is, me and Heath talked about this a little bit with Mark, is that now that we all agree that saturated fat is not the evil it was, but now it's kind of taken this huge turn to where these guys are going, okay, now load up on saturated fat. You're all, whoa, hold on a second. Yeah, saturated fat is not the cause of all of our health problems today.
Well, you know what? The first thing is saturated fat isn't a single entity. And that's what most people don't get. Saturated fat, there's multiple saturated fats. And we talk about a wild animal. So you go out and you kill a deer or an elk here in Colorado, and the hunter-gatherers absolutely went for the fatty parts of the carcass, but it was also mixed in with protein. So the ratio of the saturated fats in wild animals, we've done that research. We've published those papers. You know, so the acupressurists and these self-styled experts need to read those papers before they open their mouth. So in a wild animal, the percentage of saturated fats, palmitic acid, which is 16-0, and stearic acid, which is 18-0, they're equally distributed. And stearic acid actually tends to lower blood cholesterol, whereas palmitic acid tends to raise it. But that has been completely glossed over by the paleo community, is that when you're eating wild animals or even grass-produced animals, you're getting a balance of all these fatty acids. And that's what's crucial. And I think your point is well taken, you know. Now let's have, you know, 4 cubes of butter because saturated fat is no longer harmful for us. Yeah. But that's not the point. The point is that our bodies function well on mixtures. And we always think that if a little bit is good, more must be better. But that's not the case. And so that's the real beauty of paleo, is you let your appetite guide you. And your appetite will guide you to the correct fat to protein ratio. And everything. It will guide you to the correct protein. You guys are both athletes and you're in your prime. I consider 30s and 40s prime time when I'm 60. But you know how much or how little carb you need to get you through your day, to do your workout, to do your aerobic activities. And so you don't think about that. You don't weigh out how much carb. It's like, this is how I feel. And that's really the beauty of paleo is I think that it's you don't have to do a whole lot of thinking on it other than following the basic principles.
Yeah, obviously, yeah. People back then weren't thinking about I'm overweight or thinking about losing weight. They were just naturally fit and lean. And I think that's the real takeaway about all this is if your macros are on point, you don't have to think about weight anymore. You get to think about other things in your life that are more important than just your weight, because the weight's going to be falling off of you. You're going to be you're going to have a leaner physique just naturally. So, and that's what we want to say is like, there's so many bloggers and authors that are putting out these books that have such an emphasis on inserting honey and maple syrup and these high sugar kind of paleo recipes. We think it's a real disservice to people that are trying to lose weight and they start reading these recipe books and then all of a sudden they're like, you know what, paleo isn't working for me. I'm gaining weight or I'm stalling in my weight loss. And they can't ever reach their ideal weight, and it's all about moderation, you know.
Yeah, or they're going back to those wild blood sugar swings, and you know, I think that high glycemic load carbohydrates do that to you, and that's what's making people. That's why we have an obesity epidemic. So we really, you know, if you want to use one of those once in a blue moon as a treat, fine. But let's just don't replace, you know, the crap food that you had beforehand with this stuff.
Yeah, it's like almost every recipe book is that's generated nowadays is it's these recipes completely destroy blood sugar, and people are not having that sustained energy that they should have when following a proper paleo diet. And it's just it's horrible, and it's like it's about time people start talking about it, because so many of my friends, including my family members, have a lot of these authors' books in their homes. And they're not getting the results. And then after I explained to them that, look, you can't be inserting honey and maple syrup into in every day, and you know, or it makes sense to them. They're like, oh, okay, I get it. And then they start getting great results when they lower the sugar and they eat a proper, you know, they eat more vegetables, protein, and a moderate amount of fat. It's a very simple principle, and people can get amazing results quickly just by changing up their macros a little bit. It's not brain science. It really isn't.
I think a problem too is understand that it brings into the saturated fat issue again, into incorporating more fat, which we agree is good to a point, but what they're doing is they're eating still a high sugar diet, but replacing it with maple sugar, almond flours, and then, you know, honey, and then they turn around and then they go and have butter as well and a lot of saturated fat, not realizing that by consuming that high level of sugars again, they're blocking their body's ability to utilize fat as energy. Then they're turning around and dumping more fat into their diet that they can't utilize for energy. So what does it do? Now you store it again. So now they've actually done a disservice even more, because they're going to store fat at a higher rate because of the poor diet choices that these guys are giving them because they don't know the science.
Yeah. You know, I think one point here that I've made in my blog a few times is that people think about honey as being a healthful, natural sugar. Well, indeed, bees produce it. You know, it's not necessarily produced by human hands, but the sugar composition of honey is almost the same. There's three different versions of high fructose corn syrup. And the one that's most used is high fructose corn syrup 55. And that has 45% glucose and 55% fructose. And that combination is almost identical to what we see in honey. Honey varies based on, you know, where it's collected, but it's pretty much half and half, half fructose and half glucose. So the same damage that fructose, high fructose corn syrup does to us metabolically is what honey does to us. So I'm completely on board with you guys that, you know, use it as a treat once in a blue moon, but it shouldn't be consumed regularly.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. Well, Dr. Cordain, can you tell us a little bit what you have going on? Do you have any upcoming books? I noticed your site redesign. I love it. Obviously,
hey, thanks.
I was very flattered to be on there and my weight loss results. So can you tell us, though, a little bit more about what you have upcoming and where people can find you and what they can look forward to?
Well, you know, we've got a brand new cookbook coming out by my publishers, Houghton Mifflin Harcourt. And it's going to be called The Real Paleo Diet. And so The Real Paleo Diet Cookbook. And so all recipes are completely and totally paleo. You're not going to find any honey or maple sugar or even salt in any of the recipes. And the recipes are put together by professional chefs and tested. And it's going to be a glossy color photographs. You know, it's hopefully going to be one of the nicer, true to the paleo concept books out there. And I think that's coming out, I think maybe in the springtime. I'm not sure. I'd have to check with my publisher. So that's one that's coming out. There's another in the following year, there's going to be another book about how to do paleo on the go, how to do it quickly. Again, true to the paleo concept, because that's a lot of the I think what people worry about is, you know, how can I get real food on the go if I have to work an 8-hour day and I'm trying to work out 2 hours on top of that. So we're going to show people how to pull that off. Awesome. And then my final swan song, research-wise, you know, you guys know I retired. So yeah. I retired in December from CSU after 32 years. And so I have one final graduate student, Trevor Connor, who's also on board with us. He's going to be a writer for us at our website. Non-traditional student. He's in his early 40s. He was on the Canadian national cycling team. And his story is amazing. After going paleo in age 40, he was doing better times than he was when he was in his peak, 25 to 30-ish. Wow. So Trevor is a brilliant guy. He's kind of like you guys interviewed Mark Smith. You'll be interviewing Trevor one of these days. And Trevor we did a study in which we went out on the internet and we got over 100 people that had autoimmune disease. And we got their medical records, and then he compiled their medical records to before and after they started paleo to see if paleo was helpful for them. And the real home run that I can am proud to say, we haven't got this into the medical literature yet because the manuscript is still being written up, but the real home run that I'm proud to say, and maybe you guys can get this out anecdotally to your listeners, is that we had 10 Crohn's and ulcerative colitis patients in the cohort. And all 10 of them reported remission of their symptoms. Wow. So that to me is pretty interesting. And you know, there's no risk to doing paleo. There's absolutely no risk whatsoever nutritionally. Your nutrition will be much more nutritionally dense than what it was you're doing before. And the benefits can be huge. So people that suffer through Crohn's should give it a try because it may be helpful for them.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's really great. We want to encourage everybody to visit thepaleodiet.com. You have great recipes and great blog on there, a ton of research, and obviously your books, The Paleo Diet and Paleo Diet for Athletes. And, you know, you've done such great work. We really want to thank you for being on the show. We hope to talk to you again in the future. This is going to go out to a lot of people, and we really appreciate your time today. And, yeah, thank you.
Well, I want to thank you, Heath, and Gary as well. You guys are, you know, wonderful proponents of this idea, and I'm indebted to you for, you know, everything you both have done to help promote it.
Awesome.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we will talk to you all soon, and make sure you hit the subscribe button to keep up to date on all the Primal Show updates, and we'll talk to you soon. Thank you.